Meet the Macintosh SE 30, one of the most powerful compact Macs Apple ever made. Released in 1989, this little box sported a Motorola 68030 CPU at 16 MHz, up to 128 MB of RAM, which was unheard of at the time, and one PDS slot for expansion cards. The two machines on display run a little startup competition. On the right, it's System 6, the original OS shipped with the SE30, sleek, snappy, minimal, booting in just 30 seconds. But the Mac SE30 could also run System 7.5.5 if you were patient. Very patient. The system on the left takes a staggering 80 seconds from zero to hero. Apart from that, the SE30 would also run Apple's own Unix, AUX. But that's a story for another day, because, of course, the moment I wanted to dive in, starting off with the installation of this Asanté MacCon Ethernet adapter, one of the two decided to give up. Zebra stripes, vanishing hard drives, in short, full retro panic mode. So naturally, I did the only reasonable thing. I ran the logic board through the dishwasher, because retro tech repair isn't always about logic, but sometimes also about stubbornness. It's obsolete technology no one uses today, but I'll bring it back to life. I'm the Vintage Collector, and these are my stories. Before we dive into the Asanté MacCon adapter, a quick shout out. One of these Mac SE30s was kindly donated to me by Kevin. Thanks again for keeping vintage hardware alive. And also, a big thanks to my channel members and paid subscribers. Your support helped me to fund the MacCon Ethernet card used in this episode. If you'd like to join in, members get early access to new videos and help keep this whole thing up and running. Speaking of support, this episode is sponsored by PCBWay. PCBWay offers a wide range of services around CNC machining PCB production, including full assembly services and 3D printing. You've got the idea, they help make it real. Head over to PCBWay.com and have a look. Now, let's get closer at this MacCon card. It was only natural to get this one. A few weeks ago, we looked already into retrofitting a Farallon Ethermac adapter to a Performer 450, and you guess it, we'll soon look into Mac networking on this channel as well. This MacCon adapter came in the original box and includes the manuals. It was missing the driver's floppy disk, but I could easily recreate this from the Performer machine. But before that one comes into play, I had to open up the SE30. That's where I noticed two screw posts at the bottom of the case were broken off. So I took plastic wall anchors, cut them to length and glued them in using a two components plastics glue. With that sorted, I refitted the logic board. As I intend to install AUX on this machine, I also swapped the current 40 MB hard drive for a bigger one. No surprise, this machine didn't feature the original hard drive anymore. No big deal, because I just went to equip a 2 GB IBM SCSI drive. Like the Macintosh LC series and the Macintosh SE from 1987, this machine features a so-called processor direct slot, or PDS for short, used to add expansion cards. Had Steve Jobs still been at Apple by the time, this feature probably wouldn't have made the cut. If it were up to him, all you'd get would be a sealed box. Anyways, the PDS isn't a real bus like NewBus or PCI, it taps directly into the CPU. On the SE30, that means a 32-bit data path tied into the 68030 at 16 MHz, giving you around 16 MB per second, in theory. The MacCon Ethernet adapter comes in two parts, the mainboard and a small daughterboard that fits into the back of the case. Now, the instructions say to follow the color coding on the cable, which would be fine if it were the usual grey ribbon with a red wire. But in this case, it's a full-on rainbow. Looks nice, but makes it harder to tell which side is pin 1. Thankfully, the main adapter has pin 1 clearly marked and the ribbon has a small white dot printed on the back. That's your alignment point. Make sure those line up. As for the daughterboard, no pin markings at all. But at least the connector's nose is keyed so you can't plug it in backwards unless you really try. And this is how it should look like. So I was then trying to set up a new disk partition to prepare for the software installation. Keep in mind that when using non-Apple SCSI drives, you must use a patched version of the HDSE setup or an alternative partitioning tool like Lido. But would you be surprised if I told you it wouldn't detect the hard drive? Oh well. So I just swapped it for another disk, which was then recognized, allowing me to set up the partition suitable for AUX. We'll get into more detail of that in my follow-up episode. For today, it's enough to have the Macintosh partition in place to install System 7.1. As I didn't have a proper disk set, I had to quickly create one before diving into the installation. But the moment I wanted to get going, the SE30 started showing zebra stripes. This symptom seems to be well known, also often referred to as SimasiMac. The obvious resolution is to swap the capacitors or...
Oh no, not another round of capacitor chronicles!
Or just checking RAM and ROM modules, reseating them. Alright, I'm taking that solution up front. I really should have done that first, because as it turned out later on, one of those modules was indeed faulty. Using my creative way to avoid constantly remounting the mainboard, I was swapping out memory modules until it went away permanently.
But why didn't you do then the obvious thing first? It even says you should right here.
Well, wrong assumptions because of context information. The pre-owner had recapped this machine. But in all honesty, inspecting the mainboard more closely jumped me to the conclusion of having cold solder joints. And this would align with my experience that the machine refused to boot up more or less every other time. So I simply designed it to replace all caps by fresh ones just to be safe before putting the logic board into the dishwasher.
Into the dishwasher?
Yes. Because that can help in removing dust and dirt, and in particular, leftovers from leak capacitor fluid. It helps to first apply electronics cleaner and brushing off the areas around the capacitors with a toothbrush. And you should really remove any socketed components and the NVRAM battery as well. Oh, and don't use any soap, no taps, salt or rinse aids, nothing. Make absolutely sure the dishwasher is empty of any cleaning agents. You want only hot water, nothing else. You be warned. After this treatment, I use compression air to blow out the water and let the logic board dry for another day.
I'm sure it'll be totally dead by now.
At first. But I didn't jump this time, but was then actually checking the RAM. One by one. And guess what? The zebra stripes were gone and the machine started up, consistently. No drama, no zebra rebellion. So maybe checking the ROM up front would probably have been a better first step. On the other side, remember those solder joints, redoing them and cleaning the logic board wasn't all wrong either. I was then finally installing System 7.1, also known as System 7 Pro, and finally heading into installing the Asanté network drivers, MacTCP and MacTCP ping. Awesome, I have connectivity to my IP network. But something was still not in good order. When trying to perform some downloads, the SE30 would suddenly lock up. And on the next startup, I'd simply get this. it went to the point the machine would just show the question mark on any subsequent restarts, not booting up from the hard drive at all. Both Apple's HDSC setup and Lido would report obscure errors.
It's obvious, the hard drive has died.
Nope, it didn't, as this was just recognized fine in another machine, and also other known good drives were not recognized by this machine anymore. I suspected there was a broken trace somewhere around the SCSI ICs.
Again jumping to conclusions.
Yes, I was still caught into the capacitor's root cause trap. But after I went through checking all connections, and there's a nice schematic over here that helps you in identifying the proper pins, I wasn't so sure about it. Hence I hooked up an external SCSI drive just to see what happens. And that bloody thing was in fact booting up. Could it really be? I was then beeping through the internal SCSI cable.
It's working?
Hold on. You hear that? This seems to be a broken wire in the ribbon cable. And with that being replaced, the machine was finally working once and for all, letting me install some software and running an extended session of lemmings. Because hey, you need to do some burn-in tests, right? On a last note, I was surprised to find the signatures of the original Macintosh design team on the inside of the SC30 enclosure. It's well known that Steve Jobs brought in this idea for the original Macintosh, but somehow I was under the impression this was removed for later iterations of the Mac, especially after Jobs had left Apple in 1985. But here it is, a 1989 SE30 still featuring Jobs' signature. Either way, this SE30 is back to life and ready for an excursion into AUX next time round. Just in time before we will have a look at another famous machine carrying Steve Jobs' legacy, the Next Station. How about you? What's your take on the SE30? Did you own this powerhouse, even maxing it out to 128 MB of RAM back in 1989? Let me know in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching and see you again next Sunday.